Hello, people.
Hey, folks. My name is Keith.
And my name is Dell.
And we are Ron Joe, and we listen to cool albums. Dell, what are we listening to today?
Today, Keith, we are partying hard. Blondie, Parallel Lines.
Woohoo!
We're going to get our
1978.
Little... 1978. Yep, right at the end of the punk movement. Or right about the end of the punk movement.
Yeah, when punk started growing up and was able to grow into other things, to mature and take in other influences. And this is one of the cutting edge album from 1978 that was, you know, this is their third album. So it was their first two albums were pretty straight ahead punk. And this one shows a lot of growth, and it is just so much fun, but it's just a really musically interesting album as well. So I'm excited about this one. It's one of my favorite albums.
Here's the ragtag bunch, except for the babe in the middle. Everyone knows Deborah Harry, so I won't even talk about her. We got Frank Infante, a guitarist.
The lead guitarist.
Lead guitarist, singer, some songwriting.
Apparently, you know, one of the best, probably the best actual musician in the band,
right?
According to Mike Chapman, the producer.
Clem Burke, the
drummer.
Yep. Clem Burke, the drummer. Chris Stein, the
guitarist, husband of Deborah Harry. I don't know if they were married at this time, but they got married maybe the next year or two, and they've been married ever since. They're still married.
Nigel Harrison, the bass player. You know what he looks like? He looks like another Harrison. Jerry.
He does look like Jerry. Yeah. I wonder if they're related. They might be related, huh?
That might be, but... and Jimmy Destri. That.
Keyboard player.
The keyboardist.
Good keyboard player. Yeah, good keyboard player. Fun keyboard player. I like the stuff he does on this album. You know? And then...
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So apparently these guys were a bunch of punks, man, and New York, you know, misfits, literally not, you know, well, there was a band called the Misfits, but no, just, you know, troublemakers, man.
Yeah, troublemakers. Let's get started on this thing.
Totally.
I'm in the phone booth, it's a one across the hall. If you don't answer, I'll just bring it off the wall. Told you to ignore.
That one's fun. And that's a cover as well. That's a cover of a song by The Nerves. I never heard of The Nerves before, but composed by Jack Lee. I don't know. Cool jamming opener, man. And it was sung, I guess, The Nerves. Jack Lee is a guy. And so he was, so she's flipping it here, you know, kind of showing her feminism, right?
Her
power, the strength of a woman saying, hey, don't leave me hanging on the freaking telephone. You know?
So was that kind of in punkish, or was that new wave-ish, or was that, what were they doing there?
It's probably pop punk.
Is there a name for it?
I would call it like pop punk, punk sense. Pop. Kind of, you sort of, I don't know, who's that punk pop band that I'm seven? There's a seven something. No, 57. Green 50, Green Day? Green Day. Green Day-ish, kind of.
Green 57.
I don't know. There was some 90s band that had a sort of had that feel. It was kind of punk pop. Maybe Green Day or something
right,
like that.
Right.
You know? Yeah. Cool. Let's go on to the next man. This is a big hit. This was.
I can't help but to go from, you know, one to another on this album.
Yeah,
really,
I mean, they
it
all
just kind of that. Flows better that way.
I agree, man. Everybody knows this song. This is probably their second biggest hit, maybe third biggest hit.
Kind of a, it just reminds me. The Knack. It kind of reminds me of The Knack in a way.
This one? Yeah.
I'm gonna win ya. I'm gonna get you one way or another.
He's not
I'm gonna
shy about anything.
I'm gonna meet ya one day. Maybe next week. I'm gonna meet ya. I'm gonna meet ya. I'll meet ya.
This was actually about a stalker, or inspired by a guy who stalked her. This is the stalking part here.
I'll see
you. Like peeking in the window.
Got a lot of personality.
Expressive, man. She has fun. We can talk more about this a little bit.
Maybe next week I'm gonna meet ya. I'll meet ya. And if the lights are all out, I'll follow your post down.
Bit of Elliot Easton to the way he does his guitar.
Yeah,
very
true.
Melodic.
Yeah, expressive. He bends notes and stuff.
One way or another, right. I'm gonna lose ya.
Now she's gonna lose him.
I'll slip out of here. Or another, I'm gonna lose ya. I'm gonna trick ya. I'll trick ya. One way or another, I'm gonna lose ya. I'm gonna trick ya, trick ya, trick ya, trick ya. One way.
Love the ending here. The keyboard, cool, the
yeah, a little siren. The keyboard's kind of a police siren,
boom, 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 boom. Cool two opening tracks. Yeah, definitely starts out great on that end.
Well, yeah, so that one really was inspired by a guy who had stalked her, right? So first she's going to first she's going to like snatch the guy, and then she's going to lose him, right? So, yeah.
Yep.
It was
give him the slip.
Apparently of the hip. It was a pretty fairly traumatic experience for her, and this was kind of one of the ways that she processed it. So
You know, part of the, I mean, this album is, we've been into some deep albums lately, and this album is pretty shallow, let me say, for lack of a better term, and, you know, just kind of like, just real upfront, nothing very, but I love the way she uses her lyrics. She makes them very, very fun, very, just the way she sings them and delivers them. It works with the rhythm of the music and all that stuff. She has a very great knack for making her lyrics fit with a song musically.
If that
makes sense. Rhythmically and just, you know, just it's more about stylisms and more about, you know, becoming an instrument with the funness of it. Golly, that was terrible. But you know what I'm getting at.
She is, you know, she really took a lot of time in the studio. Apparently they actually didn't record. The record company gave them 6 months to record this record, but it took them 6 weeks. And the thing that took them so long, the band was, you know, there's a few things. First of all, the band apparently were shitty musicians. And when Mike Chapman came in, the producer, he was, you know, he had I guess it didn't take him long to realize that these guys were just a bunch of punks and that all they wanted to do was party and not, you know, cause trouble and they didn't take it seriously, right? But he saw a lot of potential and said that, you know, we're going to make a great record. You know, I'm not going to be involved in this unless it's going to be a great record. And he pretty much laid down the law and said that, you know, you guys are going to grow up and you're going to play well. You're going to learn how to play your freaking instruments. And then they went, and then he added a whole bunch of dynamics and these breaks. And he's really the one who kind of inspired them to take their songwriting seriously. So this is when Chris Stein and Debbie Harry really started writing songs together.
Connecting.
And they were already connected. They were boyfriend and girlfriend. But this is so the band. So first of all, it took the band a while to, okay, we better get our shit together, because this guy's gonna he's gonna make us rich if we let him, and then Debbie actually was the last one. The band had laid down their tracks and they were ready for her to lay down her take, right? The singing the lyrics and all that. And she's like, okay. She was just there and back in the corner, just like jotting down lyrics and working on phrasing and all that kind of stuff. And so this album, I was really when she kind of really took control of her parts, right? And so I think it really shows, right, on this album. It's just, I totally agree with you that her singing on this album, the phrasing, the melodies, her personality, the way she brings those lyrics to life and makes them personal, almost like show tunes where she's kind of playing these parts, you know, and getting a little, you know, having fun with it and being a little over dramatic or whatever. Yeah, frisky for sure.
No. Yeah, frisky, a lot of energy.
Frisky, risky. Risky and frisky.
She does bring that punk edge that, you know, she's not afraid to say anything, almost like a Chrissy Hynde. She's not afraid to say anything type of feel to it. So,
you know. Yeah, and she's playing the empowered woman, right? The empowered, and this was, you know,
right.
You know, fucking people ate it up, man. I know, I loved it. I still love it. I loved it back then. I still love it. This is such a fun album.